Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm live with you here at Speak Your Mind Show. My name is Richard DeCastro, hosting, and I have a guest here with me tonight, which I would make a quick introduction, and we're going to move right into the program. We're hoping to have a very productive, vibrant show tonight. So I have with me fellow colleague, Mr. John Lewis. How are you, my friend?
I am wonderful, Richard. That's it's nice to be here with you.
You tell me about introducing you, but I don't know how to introduce you because it goes so far back. It goes so far back is almost impossible. I mean, college days, high school days, club member,
Rotary days,
colleague. Anyways.
Engineers and Architects Association.
Engineers Association.
We've had a long
The whole long 25 yards.
Kids under the sea.
You see, so I can remember some of it, not to mention the children. Anyways, we're here tonight and we're going to be jumping on a topic, a hot topic tonight. We're going to be discussing the Panama files and how it has affected us, and we're going to engage the public because I think it's time for to go on the offensive, and I also think it's time to do some education and some re-educating so that we make sure that everybody understand what's going on, number one, and what role each and every citizen should be playing, you know, in an arena of where we find ourselves. It's a global arena. It's affecting a lot of people around the world. And as a small country, we may be small in size, but the type of business we're involved in is huge.
That is also true.
Yeah.
But the question I would ask is it about the British Virgin Islands or is it about Panama?
I think if you it's a couple of gigabytes of information, right? And it's some of it is coming out, you know, daily, right? And if you really look at what is coming from the news media, the various news medias around the world, you realize that Panama is just being used.
No, the British Virgin Islands are being used.
But that's what I was going to say. I was going to say that Panama is being used, and by extension, everybody else who was associated with those files also being used.
Are you talking about the industry, offshore?
Yes, the industry. The whole the business of offshore business.
But the business of offshore activities is not just related to or associated to small countries.
No, not at all. As a matter of fact, I was looking at something before I came, and the BVI doesn't even make the top 10 list.
Exactly. When you have Delaware, Nevada, Australia,
that's what I'm saying. There are lots of places in the world where you can, you know, conduct financial services business. So Panama wasn't even on the list as well.
Okay.
Panama was not on
London.
The list. There are lots of places where you can do financial services. I think over the years, since 1984, we have developed a product, and some of my colleagues like to talk about branding, but we have branded that product very well.
But of course, we have provided valuable services.
And by providing and by having that brand and the quality, the due diligence, the whole nine yards, the way it is put across, it is attractive to persons who need to use the service. And that is why it has been a success story.
And it will continue to be a success.
I could tell you a little story that might, you know, spur some discussion if people are listening want to interact as well. You know, when I worked for government, we were responsible for setting up the filing system to keep the files in the infant stages of the financial services. And to cut a long story short, within 2 years, we had to double the size of the files, the filing system to hold the files. And it went on and on and on like that. I mean, you would realize now that, I mean, it's...
Now we've gone digital with it, so
yeah,
makes it easier.
Now it's done digital, it's probably easier, yeah, but at the same time, it's still a lot of files.
Yes.
It's still a lot of files. And you mentioned there the digital path, and one of my associates, I was saying that it is so easy now to duplicate things and so easy to be counterproductive if you want to. If you have that negative mind and you want to be a person who is out there, and I guess we're now learning that it sounds as if that was the case with the files. It sounds as if it was a falling out situation. And because of that, where someone was getting back at somebody else, where it might have been where the initial problem started.
So that problem is 2 years old, Richard?
No, man.
It's more than 2 years old.
Much more than 2 years.
But it has taken 2 years before the first story broke.
Yeah. That's true, yeah. But still, you know, it's kind of very difficult for the territory, I think, because it puts us in a very difficult position of spending resources and personnel and everything.
It certainly is a problem for us. We have to put out a fire that doesn't belong to us.
Exactly. And I think that is something unfortunate for a small country, especially a small country which has been carrying its own weight for the past 30 years or so, right?
Correct.
I'm speaking now about the financial situation. Not the financial services, but the financial maturity that we find ourselves in at this stage. You know, before we were granting aid, we used to get money from the UK.
We used to get a pittance.
Pittance from the UK and a building here and there, right? We used to get that in the past.
And one person would decide whether we got it or not.
Right. And we graduated from that. Sometimes, John, we have to tell our own story.
It wasn't a graduation process, you know. It was thrust upon us.
It was thrust upon us. Okay. You would know more than me because I was absent for a while. But I know my good Chief Minister Willard Wheatley was instrumental in ensuring that we move from one step to another. I'm saying that to say that in addition to that, we have been taking care of things here on our own.
We've been taking care of ourselves.
Unlike some other dependent territories.
We're not Montserrat.
Well, I didn't want to say. there are more than one.
Without Turks and Caicos.
There are a few.
Without Anguilla.
Right, there are a few. And I wish they could do the same like us, you know? I really wish they could do the same like us because...
One day they will have to.
They will have to, I think, because it's not a good situation to be in a dependency because you're really at the mercy of a few. If you know the system... The Foreign and Commonwealth Office is responsible for the livelihood of dependent territories. Everything has to go through the Foreign and Commonwealth. In other words, if the UK budget is passed and the Foreign and Commonwealth Office has a reduction, that reduction is automatically passed on to the territories, right? So we have graduated out of that stage and we are in a stage where we have been pretty much defending ourselves as far as, you know, the financial...
Is it possible that it is that success which angers some people?
I think very much so, you know, John. I am of the opinion that since the United Kingdom made an arrangement for Bermuda, which is internal self-government,
mm-hmm.
It seems as if they have made a decision not to do that again to the other dependent territories. And now we're seeing a further cementing of that idea, that they don't want persons to be so independent but still being under their umbrella, so to speak.
Perhaps that's what Corbyn wants.
Perhaps what?
Corbyn, the leader of the opposition, wants to scrap the Bermuda model and just swoop in on the British Virgin Islands.
On all the territories.
Cayman Islands.
On all the territories.
Anguilla.
On all the territories. That is his idea.
But why the Cayman Islands and the British Virgin Islands? Is it because so much of the world's finances pass through our systems?
It could be that, or it could be what we were discussing earlier. It could be the success.
That's it.
It could be the success. If we were not successful
in what we do,
we would be asking for assistance or granting aid.
Do you realize, Richard, that the American banking system depends heavily on the Cayman Islands system?
Of course.
Where monies are funneled through and funneled out on a daily basis just to keep the economic systems going?
Yeah. I also know, too, that persons are speculating that maybe some American companies may start to surface as a result of the Panama files as well. And it wouldn't be surprising to me, you know, because I know that the vehicles that are in financial services institutions in the Caribbean and in Asia, these are vehicles that people use to do business, to carry out business, to carry out regular operations, especially for corporations.
One guy put it this way, that the offshore services are like a plumbing system. Monies come in, and we make sure that it is safe before it goes out.
Well, there's a lot of discussion too now since the information is out there. We have seen persons had to resign. We've seen the guy in Iceland had to resign. We've seen they had a live protest today in London against the Prime Minister, and there's a lot of speculation about persons in China being affected by this thing as well. So it's very broad, and it seems like the information is coming out piecemeal. It's not coming out all at one time.
My understanding is that there's a series.
Okay. Well, John, as usual, the sponsors that make the show possible is asking us for a break. So we're going to take a break, and we're going to be right back with you.
I'm aware that the competent authorities have initiated an investigation process. I will take action where necessary. The BVI always actively investigates issues of non-compliance. In fact, we work with foreign competent authorities to detect, prevent, and prosecute illegal activities. This is important to us because we want to ensure that our laws are enforced and actions taken transparently when we identify wrongdoing. We continue to play a constructive role in the furtherance of international transparency, information exchange, and anti-money laundering initiatives at the highest level. This afternoon, I'm pleased to announce that after several rounds of technical discussions and exchanges between the BVI and the United Kingdom law enforcement authorities since the 2015 Joint Ministerial Council, the government of the British Virgin Islands and the UK government have reached an agreement to enhance cooperation between our respective law enforcement authorities in the fight against international financial crime. Earlier today, I've agreed to sign an exchange of notes on beneficial ownership with the United Kingdom that builds on a successful existing relationship and the daily exchanges between the BVI and the UK law enforcement authorities remain in regular contact. The agreement also bolsters the BVI's ongoing international cooperation with other jurisdictions around the world, particularly for fellow members of the Egmont Group of Financial Intelligence Units, and is complementary to the jurisdiction's good standing in meeting our international commitments on tax transparency and anti-corruption under FATCA, OECD, FATF, and the United Nations. In effect, we have agreed on the principles and process for improving information exchange with the United Kingdom. The exchange of notes also meets our JMC Communique 2015 commitments with the United Kingdom, in which we agree to further developing a timely, safe and secure information exchange process to increase our collective effectiveness for the purpose of law enforcement in relation to beneficial ownership. The BVI's long-standing commitment to international standards on tax and transparency, our robust regulatory regime, and enhanced cooperation with the United Kingdom underscores our continuous efforts to maintain the integrity of the international financial system. As Premier Minister of Finance, I can assure the public and our international partners that the BVI will remain a jurisdiction of the highest integrity and a reliable international partner. As an international finance center, the British Virgin Islands have always prided ourselves on robust regulation in maintaining the integrity of our jurisdiction and doing our part to maintain the integrity of the wider international financial system in which we operate.
Yes, ladies and gentlemen, we're back with you after a short break. We're just listening to the Premier and his take on where we should be going and how vigorous we're going to approach, you know, the problem that we see here in the territory. I have my two guests here with me tonight. I have Mr. George, Mr. Lewis. You could expand on anything you have to add now. We're going to have like an open discussion on various aspects of, you know, where we find ourselves with the Panama Files and, you know, what you think we should be doing. I'll start with you, John.
The other day, I received a clip with one of our publishers of our news, local newspapers, and he vigorously defended the British Virgin Islands.
Okay.
But one of the things that he didn't tell the reporter from London was that it took us 10 years to build our hospital, one. Two, that we think our hospital, even though it cost us $100 million, is as good as we in the British Virgin Islands deserve. And thirdly, if he checked his facts, he would realize that we're still paying the banks for those monies that built our hospital. There was no dirty money involved in it. Okay. Beyond that, I think he did justice to opposition. He stuck to the facts. He didn't let this guy from England bulldoze him into a position where he became defensive. He was really good and on target with his position towards the British Virgin Islands. And what we do a legitimate business. It is not a crime, it is totally legal. And because we do such a good job, Courtney, so many people follow our standards.
Okay, Brother George?
Well, I have to agree. The publisher did a real good job, because if it was me, I don't know if I could have done as good a job as him.
Okay.
I might have lose my head, and especially when the man asks how we pay for our hospital. We get loans. I think that was some of the loan money from Social Security. We, the people of the Virgin Islands, build our hospital. So I don't know where he get his thing from, a dirty money. And to me, this whole Panama Papers, if you have over two terabytes, over 200, 2,000 documents, how come you're only picking on the BVI? You really trying to tell me the BVI is the only place that had corruption in it? How about Switzerland? How about same America, Delaware? How about England? How come you only picking on the BVI? We were the number one in the world.
Well, they have to pick on us because they allege that the money is in the British Virgin Islands.
But we don't have no money here.
But the reality is, we don't have any major investments circulating in our economy. We don't have any major projects that one can say, this is dirty money. Yes, we are the means by which Mr. A is in China. He wants to do some business in
Germany or wherever.
In South America. But he has to put his money in a place that's safe. Mm-hmm. A place where you have a legal system that is based on British common law. A place where there is a commercial court. A place where he feels that if he has to take his matter to court, he will get a free, a safe and honest hearing in the British Virgin Islands. So he uses all services for his transactions. It's as simple as that.
Mm-hmm. Simple as that. Mm-hmm. That's the whole point. That's the whole thing of financial services. That's what we do. So I don't understand why the whole world trying to destroy us, because we're not the only ones that do it. And it's a legal business. I really don't understand. To me, it's like a plot. Just trying to take all customers from us.
Mm. Well, you're aware, though, that this is not the first time that we've been under attack for financial services.
I think from time before, you know, that we were number one. We had like a listing where the BVI...
We're not number one.
Well, number three, number two, we were up
number
high.
Number 21.
Well, number 21.
Yeah.
These boys, we supposed to be up there. Mm-hmm. That's what they say.
We're not supposed to be there at all.
Yeah. You're too smart. You hear what I'm saying? With 30,000 people, mm-hmm. why we have $100 million
hospital?
Really? Yeah. That's the mindset that they have about us.
My take on that part of it, of the interview was that England did not assist us as an overseas territory. They have stopped assisting us now for about 30 years, right? So it seems to me like we have fallen down on the education side of educating the UK mm-hmm. about what we do. I think we have fallen down in that aspect. And we need to step it up.
I guess if my memory serves me right, mm-hmm. the last major investment the British government provided to the British Virgin Islands mm-hmm. is a prison.
No, there were the Darwin Initiative and a couple of other smaller things. But in terms of infrastructure. You're correct. Balsam got
was the last major. Yeah. Yes, they've given some monies as part of the EU project towards the hospital and other minor things.
Yeah.
But the last major investment they've provided for infrastructure.
They were just fulfilling Peter Tosh. That's all they were doing. I don't mean to make it so comical, but that's part of one of Peter Tosh's songs. They're only building prisons, and that was a fact, because the prison was built here at the same time where one was built in Turks and Caicos, and one in Cayman Islands.
Oh, so it's part of a.
It was a program.
Okay.
It was a ACT was the.
So that's the only thing that they can do that's meaningful mm-hmm. is a means of incarcerating.
Well, I think if you look at a public opinion and what's happening in the UK right now, today they had a demonstration calling for elections in the UK, right? And you're seeing more public response to things as they happen now, which I think is good in a way. But we, as a people, we need to put out there our position, what we do, right? What happens in our country? Because a lot of people, I am ashamed to even say, but a lot of people in the UK are ignorant to what goes on in the territories, especially in our territory.
Is there any reason for them to be knowledgeable?
Well, it's to our advantage to make them knowledgeable.
Why?
Because you heard the kind of rhetoric. I've had someone ask me already if we have cars in the Virgin Islands,
but Richard,
in the UK.
But Richard,
in the UK,
if they want to withdraw mm-hmm. from the European common market.
Yes.
Something they championed. Why should they be overly concerned about us? It's in their backyard.
Yeah.
And they want to separate themselves from it because they want to be the big bullies.
Yeah.
It sort of reminds me of some night ago I was looking at old cricket history.
Okay.
And how they treated West Indies.
Right.
And when we went to Australia, we were made to grovel. Mm-hmm. When we go back to England, mm-hmm. and we made them grovel, mm-hmm. they wanted to change the rules.
Okay.
So that is nothing new.
Yeah. Well, you're on that topic, don't forget, West Indies just beat Britain.
Well, we know that, but okay. We won't talk about cricket tonight.
We're not talking about that right now. We're staying focused.
Yes.
We're staying focused with what we're talking about.
And perhaps we need to talk about some of the things that we do in the British Virgin Islands relative to the economic development and what the offshore structure that exists will do for us. And yes, we provide valuable services to global commerce, and it is stable, internationally recognized area. That's what we do. We are law-abiding. We have legitimate investors who chose the British Virgin Islands because it offers a structural advantage that delivers management control and access to new markets while treating all investors equally or as commercially agreed. Our advantages are credible and efficient dispute resolution and an effective exit strategy. That's what we do. We do it right.
Well, saying that, right away puts us in the mode that I'm saying. We need to put out more information about what we do and how we do what we do.
Okay.
Not even just to England, maybe more to the
local. To the local. We need to understand.
That's what I'm saying.
We need all of us to get on a page where we could defend the BVA.
Exactly.
But if we don't know or we don't understand what financial services, you could pick up, you go to a bar right now and ask a regular man,
mm-hmm.
what do you know about financial services?
Mm-hmm.
By me, you know.
Mm-hmm.
The average person cannot defend the BVA, and that's who we need to defend, because you might be in the office, you're in on the road, yeah. you're not interacting with the tourists, who yeah. might come and have a wrong perception in their brain. It's the small man, the regular man on the street.
Mm-hmm.
We're here to defend. So whoever in charge, whoever on the marketing, just need to...
Needs to be a campaign.
Yeah, need to inform us more.
Public education.
Yeah.
Yes, I think so, yeah.
Okay.
We have a text that came and said, good night. Why, when the hospital was building and it took the government how many years to complete these negative things, we're not saying the BVI deserves the best? Well, I think that's just the nature of the beast. That people look at negativity and they run with it, so to speak.
Yeah, negative.
Another text can say, Courtney, don't negative you know where your source, your information, but the BVI is not 21. John, you obviously don't know very much about what you are talking. Speak ad lib. if you don't believe my source, you can always go and check yourself. You can check reliable sources like the BBC. You could check other reliable
sources. Globe.
The Globe. Don't go to the Mirror and those gossip.
How about the Financial Times?
The Financial Times. There are a lot of reputable sources that you can go and search for. That's another thing. A lot of our people refuse to look for first-hand information, right? First-hand information is out there.
Okay, there's a lady, Vanessa Holder, who put out an article which says, tax havens are cog in global economy,
mm-hmm.
and they are defending the offshore center. I'm sorry that person thinks that I'm not.
Yeah. I'm sorry too, because I think we're all on the same page here on this desk where we're informed, and we are trying to inform the general public about some of the intricacies that are involved with the financial services at this time as we speak. Something else, in Canada, this is the put out that one of the richest women in Canada, her company is here in the BVI, right? And the lady doesn't live in Canada, as a matter of fact, right? She have already left Canada, but because she has Canadian citizenship, they're putting it out that she has companies here. And the article speaks that it is not illegal to have companies.
It is not.
Okay, it is not an illegal act to have companies. Companies are a vehicle for doing business. In other words, if you have good lawyers and good accountants, and you have assets that you have to manage, the BVI is a place where you can manage those assets.
If the caller or the sender of the text wants to know, mm-hmm. the BVI is tax neutral. Mm-hmm. We don't collect any taxes from the money people put in the Virgin Islands. All we get is what we get paid for our services.
I think if you're following what the arguments are in the international media, though, it's not that we tax people, right? But that people don't pay taxes in their own jurisdiction or in their own country where they're from as a result of having, you know, these types of vehicles, which is true. That is a fact, okay? But it is not illegal.
But Juliet Samuel says the significant tax gap calculated by Her Majesty's Revenue and Customs was in 2013-2014 was $16.5 billion, pounds. And that was caused by small businesses in the United Kingdom not paying their taxes. Mm-hmm. Right. It has nothing to do with us.
Mm-hmm. See, I got another text that came in. The text came in and said, I listened to BBC News. They said BVI have 30,000 and bill $100 million hospital. Yeah, we all hear the same thing. The person that texts, I heard that. That's history.
I wonder if that person thinks that is too good for us.
I don't know if they think it's too good for us, but at the same time, I mean, that is, you can't just listen to one story.
I agree.
You have to listen to all the stories.
But that person should also know that we're still paying for that hospital. Mm-hmm. It wasn't built with $100 million in cash at once. Mm-hmm. It has taken us 10 years plus to get where we are today.
I think Bermuda has really gone on the offensive. One of the members of parliament, he came out and he said to the British government to stop lumping Bermuda with the other overseas territories, because Bermuda has a register of interest for 17 years. And the UK is now having a register for the first time. And here's a country having a register for the first time trying to advise people who have a register for 17 years. So it goes back to representation as well. We have no representation in the House of Parliament.
In the House of Commons?
In the House of Commons, yeah. Okay? We have zero, we're a territory. So if they want to have some fairness, maybe they could, I agree with one of the articles in Bermuda, they should give us some seats in Parliament in the UK.
Like the French have in Martinique and Guadeloupe.
Exactly.
Maybe that's why you don't find offshore centers in Guadeloupe and Martinique.
Maybe.
Because they can't treat them the same way
they can't.
Britain treats us.
They can't. That is correct. But you know, it's interesting the type of discussions we're having as a result of the papers, because I think we can see now that the issues surrounding the papers are far more, you know, complex and far more, you know, politically reaching than just the papers themselves.
Yeah, that is true.
For example, the, you know, citizenship is becoming a very important issue as it relates to the papers, because when you start looking at the Asian side of things, where business is done in Asia, you're looking at the major players, Google and the other big companies, and they have the same arrangement in Asia as is here in the BVI, where they have companies that handle their financial affairs through offshore industries, through the offshore industry. And the same issues are coming up there as well, which is the registration of the owners of the various companies. And so far as I know, it is not happening there, and I don't think it should happen here.
Okay.
I do not think it should. I think if it happens there, the business is going to leave. That's what I believe. Because one of the reasons for the businesses being here is because they have that assurance that they have private business and it's protected by law.
And that's only fair.
It's only fair because they're paying for it as well.
Yeah.
Right? Ladies and gentlemen, we have to take a break for the sponsors that make the show possible. We're going to be right back with you. Ladies and gentlemen, we are back with you after a short break. We're here discussing the Panama Papers, and we're having some of a discussion which we're going to get to, but a text came in. Let me see what the text said. It said, I know the government is still paying because when the government need money, they will say they borrowed money from different places. We are small, but good governance, we can make it. Yeah, text. Good governance. We have to strive for good governance always. One of the things we were talking about was education. We need to educate our people about, you know, the financial services industry that we have here and where it came from, where it is, and where it's going. We need to tell our people that something like 2/3 of our budget, John. The budget that we just have, $330 million, 2/3 of that money is accounted for through financial services. The monies that come in through incorporation, through annual fees, when you file different documents for companies, etc. In other words, the business of financial services accounts for that. Not to mention the positions, the various job positions in the various trust companies, and you know, all the way down to the smallest positions, which is the cleaning and the office rental, etc. Those are not I don't think those are accounted for when I talk about the 2/3. That's in addition to the 2/3. So you see, it's an industry that affects our livelihood in many more ways than persons might be aware of.
Can I give you a quote, Richard,
and
tell me who said this?
Okay.
In terms of my own financial affairs, I have no shares, no offshore trusts, no offshore funds, nothing like that.
Mm-hmm. Go again.
In terms of my own financial affairs,
okay.
I have no shares, mm-hmm. no offshore trusts, mm-hmm. no offshore funds, mm-hmm. nothing like that. Who do you think would have said those words?
I ain't sure who would have said those words.
David Cameron.
Well,
Prime Minister of England.
He has taken back those words since.
He has?
Yes. He has admitted. You see, the Downing Street protest call for Cameron to resign. Those are some of the things that are happening in the UK. Well, you know, would have already happened because they're 4 hours ahead of us. Yes, okay. But this is what's happening, ladies and gentlemen. We're in a situation where I think we have to go on the offensive. The defense. We have to be.
No, we have to be on the offense. We can't be defending our legal, constitutional position. We have a right mm-hmm. to use money legitimately mm-hmm. for our people. Mm-hmm. Now, one economist in England states that we should tax people if we want to raise funds legitimately. Well, so be it. But if we increase taxes beyond the point where we can't afford to live, what happens to our people? Is this a way of driving us away from our birthright?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But I just want to share a quote with you
mm-hmm.
about the offshore financial services industry.
Mm-hmm.
It says, it's the plumbing infrastructure
mm-hmm.
for globalization,
mm-hmm.
helping to move capital from developed mm-hmm. to developing countries efficiently. That
okay.
is the mechanism they all use.
Okay, I'm gonna read a text for you that just came in. I would text a kind of Courtney, no disrespect to you or your guests, but I think it would have been responsible for you as host of your program to provide the viewing public with the financial services background of your guests. You see, that's exactly what we were speaking about. The person that texts that. I'm saying that each and every one of us have got to become experts now. We have to know what's going on in the country. We cannot continue to act as if we don't know what's happening. We have to become knowledgeable, and we have to put ourselves in a position to be authoritative when we're speaking. The international media is here. Before I came, I saw the international media at Mossack and Fonseca. Okay? So it's not, and the show that we have, the premiere address, everything is live. It's on the media. We have to be responsible.
Well, I wonder if that person who sent the text even had the time to read the mm-hmm. Beacon.
Yeah.
There's a 2-page spread on the Beacon, and it says Panama leak shines spotlights the Virgin Islands.
Yeah.
And that is not a leak. I mean, that looks like a floodgate open or mm-hmm. theft.
Mm-hmm. It's something along that line.
You can't leak mm-hmm. that volume of information
mm-hmm.
and hold on to it for 2 years plus
mm-hmm.
before
mm-hmm.
you put an article out there.
Well, you're saying exactly my thoughts, because I have discovered to some extent that it is possible that was a very inside person who deliberately it reminds me of the dress that the lady kept for a couple of years. and these are things that people do, you know,
mm-hmm.
To be in the media, to be in the spotlight. Sometimes you have to be a cold, calculated person. And, you know,
Just to hurt a few people.
And we're caught up in that. I mean, be that as it is, we are caught up in it. So let's move on. Let's get in damage control mode and start doing what we have to do. I think education. We need to educate our people.
Yeah.
About the financial services industry. We need to have more persons on board than persons asking questions.
Oh, it's okay.
I have another text that came in. Let's see what the person is saying. The text came in and said, are you going to provide backgrounds? Well, caller, I don't know what more you want me to provide as far as backgrounds.
Me?
Yes, we...
What we need background for? I don't understand.
Is anyone to know my guest background on financial services?
But we're talking about that issues in the public. We ain't getting into financial services.
Exactly.
So I don't understand what the question about.
Mm-hmm. Well, my background is I read and I listen.
Yeah.
And I do have an opinion.
No, but all of us in the territory, that's exactly what we should be doing. We should be paying attention even more so now. Before this scenario, in the UK or other places, they never show a map of the BVI. They would tell you it's two little small dots that you can't see. Now they have from Anigata to Josh Van Dyke. I've seen it online.
Not even in the UK alone, everywhere.
Everywhere, right?
all over the internet, all over Facebook.
Exactly.
The BVI getting highlighted.
Exactly. Although it's a negative highlight, but at the same time, I think we have an opportunity to turn it around.
Yeah.
and look at the good out of it rather than looking at the bad of it. And I think I need to say again too that I think that, you know, the whole idea of a registry, as the UK was calling for, you hear my words, I'm choosing my words good, was calling for, okay? Mm-hmm. And the debate that's going on right now with Bermuda and other other countries about how the register should be and what it should contain and whether it should be open or closed or whatever. I tend to agree with those guys in Bermuda. I think the country should have the register, but the register should be for the country.
Country.
And that's what I think. I think the day we give up that, we give up the industry.
Well, we ought to use a system where it says, mm-hmm. if somebody else wants the information, mm-hmm. there ought to be a legal process.
There is.
There is a legal process to be followed.
And as you mentioned earlier, we have the business court.
Yes, the commercial court
that is set up right here in Rotown, in the capital of the country.
We've had major cases where billions of dollars were determined who the rightful owners are.
Yes, that's a matter of record.
But if you were to look at where the British Virgin Islands stand as a jurisdiction where our regulations are, mm-hmm. we know that it is the world's leading international finance center for facilitating the flow of foreign investment. Mm-hmm. And this is a quote from a major newspaper.
Okay.
It is not John's words, mm-hmm. but this is a fact.
Okay. Well, John, I don't think anyone would dispute the fact that over the years, the Virgin Islands has developed a product. And to quote one of the journalists, if you have a good product,
you're gonna try and copy it.
People are gonna copy it, but it's going to be sought after.
Yes.
If you have a good product, people are going to want that good product. And they're going to use it if it's good for them.
Yes.
And supply and demand. We are supplying a service, it's in demand. And that's why people are using it. That's why you have over 450,000, 500,000 companies here. Because of the fact that the product is a good product. It has been tweaked and retweaked over time. The financial services legislation that we have right now, it's not the same as we had in 1984.
Of course not.
It has been. I wouldn't want to be corrected by anyone out there, but if we had to put together the number of pieces of legislation that was passed since then, I'm pretty sure it could be anywhere close to 100.
What if I told you, Richard, that onshore jurisdictions are no better than what we have in the British Virgin Islands? Take Nevada, mm-hmm. Delaware, and Wyoming, for example. Mm-hmm. Companies don't even have to record who their owners are.
It's funny that you're raising that because I saw one article that speaks to why you are not seeing many American names showing up in the Panama
files. Because they don't exist.
Because of the same reason you were saying, because they can do the same business in America already.
Yes.
So, you see, that is one of the problems I find with the whole issue of financial services. We don't have enough education about it on a regular basis within the territory and even further beyond.
Yeah, that's a big problem.
Yeah, that's
it. It is a big problem.
But you can even see from even America. How come we is like they overregulate in the Caribbean? I keep saying this is a plot to destroy these Caribbean countries. How come in Nevada and in Delaware, they don't have the same regulation as
them? It's not a matter of overregulating. Mm-hmm. They feel that the monies which pass through our banks mm-hmm. should really remain in the United States. Mm-hmm. And okay. if you look at what happens in the Cayman Islands, the banks use that mechanism to make money in the United States. Mm-hmm. All the profits don't stay in the Cayman Islands. Mm-hmm. A little of that stays, but it comes in and it goes out. If all of the $1 trillion that they allege mm-hmm. passes to the British Virgin Islands over here, mm-hmm. you and I and Richard should be very wealthy people.
Yeah. She got mega yacht house waiting on us.
But we're not. The most of the 30,000 plus people are still living from day to day. Mm-hmm. If we are taxed any higher than we are taxed, mm-hmm. we will have serious trouble.
Mm-hmm. And on that note, John, one of the things that came out of, you know, reading some of the information about the Panama Files is that very rich people will always find a way,
of course,
to protect their assets.
Of course.
And persons who use financial services are people who have lawyers and accountants who can afford to use the loopholes in the system to their advantage.
Poor people can't afford to use the advantages.
And exactly. And poor people will never be able.
I'm reminded of the story that I read in history that armies were not created for the peasants. Because the peasants have nothing to protect.
That's true.
Armies were created
for the rich.
For the rich. Mm-hmm. And these systems, mm-hmm. these lawyers, mm-hmm. these concessions given mm-hmm. are given to those who can afford to pay for them.
Yeah. It's a one unfortunate area of it, right, is that in some countries they use taxpayers' monies to put it aside, so to speak.
There will always be those who would want to cheat.
Yeah,
no matter what system you put in place.
That's true. They're going to want to cheat. But and like I was saying before too, you know, this issue of citizenship, where you belong to and what the rules in that country are, comes out in the Panama Papers, because it's not the same for everybody, right? Canada have one set of rules, the UK have another set of rules, there are another different set of rules in China, in Russia, etc. And we're seeing that how different persons are affected, it depends on your home country and what your home country rules and laws are. Just like here. All laws here are set up specifically for the Virgin Islands. And it's a success story, in my opinion, for us. So I think, you know, that is the reason why I was propagating that we need to educate the public. We really need to let from the smallest children to the elderly, we need to let them know exactly how the country is run and what we do and how we are benefiting from it and how important it is to us.
Coming out of all of these discussions, Richard, mm-hmm. we're hoping that the government, the financial services and government will create some mechanism by which we are educated.
Mm-hmm. I have a text that came in. It says, Courtney, the subject of a registry may be a reality sooner or later, but do believe the FSC has even thought about the type of security futures that would be required to protect the data Mossack Fonseca was hacked. Someone obviously had enough interest personally and saw the gain to ruin the lives of a lot of people worldwide. Tonight's show so far is very positive. Good night to all. Now that's a very very positive text, and I thought about that as well. I thought about how secure can you really be, because there are people out there, John, who, I don't know if you're aware, but they can read your email. They can shut you down. I'm talking from personal experience, okay? And you know, some people do it for kicks. But obviously, the people who can do it to hurt other people, and this is definitely a case, in my opinion, of what has happened. For the little of what I've been able to decipher so far, it seems like it's a personal thing, and it's very sad, in my opinion, because of the amount of people that are affected by it.
Okay, Richard. I'm now learning that tax mitigation is a legitimate business purpose. However, the BVI's leading corporate advantages is not tax driven.
Hold that just a minute. Yeah, good evening. You're really speaking mine. Go ahead, please.
Courtney, I would like to know if there's any result that the BVI government could take on. The BVI government could take on that reporter when you're accusing us to using dirty money.
Well, the Premier said something to that effect tonight.
Yeah, I think the Premier has made it quite clear that an investigation is going to be carried out. And I don't think it's an investigation on one aspect of it. I think it's going to go the whole full length.
Yeah, because he accused us of using dirty money, and he should prove where the dirty money is. Because nobody is paying for that that hospital right now.
The dirty money doesn't stay here.
I hear what you're saying. What is your whole take on the Panama files, though? You want to share that with us?
It's sort of outrageous, really. Because I really thought you were going to put some licks on Mr. Willock to be here,
My colleague could handle himself, man. Don't worry about that.
Anyway, you have a good night.
All right, thank you. Yeah, John, I think we're getting close to getting to the end of the show, and Mr. George here, but we could have some.
There's more to be said.
There's more to be said, and there's more work to be done. Okay, I am definitely of the opinion that we have to be more vigilant and we have to be more forthright with what we're doing as it relates to the industry from here on forward. I don't want to knock the industry, because we know it's properly set up. We have my colleague who is the in charge of the entire operation, Mr. Mateus and whatnot. But I think that there must be a country strategy, okay, for informing the general public, right, and for having the general public knowledgeable about key aspects of the industry.
Yeah. And I want to hope that the Premier and his administration will look at the whole concept of educating the community as an ongoing exercise, so that when another blast,
because it will happen again,
when another,
we know it will happen again, right?
Name and shame,
yes,
game comes up,
yeah,
we will know that, listen, this is just another of these exercises just to discredit us, but here are the facts.
Yeah.
We are the best at what we do.
Yeah. And we have to choose our partners carefully.
Yes.
We have to be very careful choosing our partners, because if we choose our partners and our partners disappear, or they refuse to back you in the process, that is a problem.
Are you suggesting that Britain should have been?
No, I'm not suggesting that Britain should have been our partner. Britain is our partner.
But they should be protecting
they
us.
They should have been protecting us. And I think that is unfortunate, the way it has turned out to be, right? But we were fishermen and farmers and bootleggers and cane cutters and and a number of things.
So
and we survived.
Huh? You see if we're going to go back there?
No, I'm not suggesting that we're going to go back there. But I'm saying we are resilient.
Okay.
When I say we, I'm talking about my ancestors and your ancestors.
Yeah.
And John's ancestors. We were resilient. Regardless of what happened to us in the past, we were resilient and we continue to be resilient. And give a final word and let's
I want to thank you for the opportunity to be with you tonight.
The pleasure is ours.
Speak your mind.
Yeah.
And if the people want to know more about John Lewis, they can ask me.
Okay. give some last words, Mr. George.
It was a nice show. And just like a government to inform the public some more. You could do some more, do a whole campaign to educate the people. Because we need to really know what's financial services, and the regular man really don't know what's going on, and you need people to help defend this thing. So inform us so we can help you.
Okay. Well, ladies and gentlemen, we had an awesome show. We talked about how Bermuda is affected. We talked about the UK, the demonstration in UK. We talked about Canada, how Canada. I mean, this is a worldwide issue that we're dealing with right now. I can't say any more to express to as many people as possible to be vigilant and to read and to keep abreast of what's happening in the industry, because it affects our lives in more ways than you may think. All in all, we had a very good show, and at this time I usually say God bless these Virgin Islands and the people who live in them, and we'll see you again next week.